Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the kind introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my great honor and pleasure to give this plenary lecture at COMPLAS 2017. Next, I'd like to acknowledge the cooperation with my associates, Eva Binder, Hui Wang, Thomas Schlapper, Jialong Zhang, Yong Yuan, and Bernhard Pichler from the Institute for Mechanics of Materials and Structures of Vienna University of Technology and from the College of Civil Engineering at Tongji University in Shanghai. The object of research is the tunnel, bridging the gap, as it said in the title, between the two parts of the Hong Kong-Zhuhai-Macao Bridge, bridging the gap again between cities on opposite sides of the mouth of the Pearl River into the South China Sea. The length of the bridge is 35.6 kilometers. The length of the tunnel is 5.7 kilometers. Start of construction was in December 2009, and opening for the public transport is scheduled for the end of 2017. This figure here shows an aerial view of the Hong Kong-Zhuhai-Macao Bridge. The tunnel stretches between two artificial islands. The upper part of the figure shows a longitudinal cross-section. The maximum water depth of the tunnel element immersion is 44.5 meters, so the sea is relatively shallow at the mouth of the Pearl River. The length of a typical tunnel element is 180 meters. It consists of 8 segments, they're shown in the lower part of the slide, of 22.5 meters length. And the dimensions of the cross-sections are shown in the right part of the lower part of the figure. This slide here shows seven tunnel segments of 22.5 meters length, and the lower part of the figure shows a typical cross-section. The underlying research project on which I'm going to report has the title Bridging the Gap by means of multi-scale structural analysis. It started in 2015 and will end in 2018. Financial support is provided by the Austrian Science Fund and the China Scholarship Council. The figurative gap between concrete microstructures and tunnel linings is the mechanical counterpart of the aforementioned topographical geographical gaps. The aim of this research project is an assessment of the added value of multi-scale analysis of tunnel segments by means of a comparison of results with the ones from experimental tests carried out at Tongji University, Shanghai, and with results from conventional structural analysis. I will report on research in progress in the aforementioned research project, in particular I'll briefly report on 4 topics. The title of the first one is Microstructural Analysis of Impact and Blast Loading of Tunnel Linings. See also the lecture of Eva Binder in the IS Multiscale Modeling of Concrete and Concrete Structures 2 on September 7. The title of the second topic is Multiscale Analysis of Thermal Stresses in Cement Linings Due to Sudden Temperature Changes. See also the lecture by Hui Wang in the above IS. The third topic is experiments and finite element modeling of concrete linings in mechanized tunneling. See also the lecture by Thomas Schlapperl, which will be given by Bernhard Pichler in the above IS. And the last lecture has part of the lecture has the title Multiscale Structural Analysis of a Segmented Tunnel Ring. See also the lecture by Jialong Zhang in the above IS. The motivation for the first part of my lecture, first topic is treatment of exceptional load cases in tunneling by means of multiscale analysis. Traffic accidents and explosions result in high dynamic loading of concrete linings. The question that arises here is, can high dynamic strengthening be modeled by multi-scale analysis? Experimental evidence is that strength increases with increasing loading rate. Please take a look at the figure here. It shows the dynamic strength increase factor, DIM, which is equal to the ratio of the dynamic strength over the static strength. And you can see that, indeed, the strength increases. You see here values from tests that have been carried out by various authors. And you see that, indeed, the strength increases with increasing loading rate, which is well known. There is particularly much experimental evidence for uniaxial compression. And this was the basis for our elastobrittle model based on nanoscopic observations for cementitious materials, using experimental data for the cement-based, the mortar, and concrete. Failure was assumed to start when the static strength is reached. Crack propagation is assumed to occur along nanoscopic interfaces in the loading direction. The speed of cracking is approximately equal to the Rayleigh wave speed, and this is approximately equal to the shear wave speed. The dynamic strength is reached when the first crack splits the specimen. The formula on top of this slide shows the dynamic intensity factor. It contains the stress rate, which is equal to the strain rate, epsilon dot, multiplied by the modulus of elasticity. And it contains a ratio, L sub C over nu sub S, which denotes the duration of the failure process. Nu sub S is defined on the top of the slide, and L sub C is the relevant crack propagation length. That is the length across which the relevant crack must propagate to split the sample. There are two reasons for the scatter of the dynamic intensity factor. A, the uncertainty regarding the quasi-static strength, and B, the uncertainty concerning the position from which the relevant crack starts to propagate, defining L sub C. This suggested determination of a B quantile of the assumed log normal distribution of the compressive strength. The respective formula contains the mean strength, F hat, from experiments. S bar stands for the standard deviation of the assumed log normal distribution of the compressive strength values. And U sub B, U as a function of B, is a value that cuts an area of P percent of the standardized normal distribution, exhibiting a vanishing mean value. The two figures at the lower end of the slide refer to the bounds of the crack propagation length. The left figure to the upper bound, assuming that the crack starts at the top surface, and the right figure to the lower bound, assuming that the crack starts in the middle and propagates in both directions. The hypothesis was tested by reanalyzing concrete experiments by Kuhn. Since L sub C is known from the experiments, only take a look perhaps at the right lower figure. You see here L sub C is approximately H over 2. Only the scatter of F static is considered. And the diagram shows that the model agrees quite well with the test results. And it also shows that the scatter of the static strands decreases with increasing strain rate. So the conclusion from this part of the research is that no matter how short a stress pulse exceeding the quasi-static strength may be, tunnel linings will be damaged. I'm coming to the second part, the motivation for which is treatment of thermal degradation of tunnel linings by means of multiscale analysis. The figure shows the Mont Blanc highway tunnel after the accident in March 1999. A change of temperature results in thermal eigenstrains in the concrete lining. In general, thermal stresses will occur, and they may lead to cracking. There are several reasons for these stresses. One is, of course, and that's well known, in stationary heat conduction. inevitably activating macroscopic thermal stresses, kinematic constraints, preventing temperature-induced deformations, also resulting in thermal stresses. And what has not been treated very much in the literature is the mismatch of thermal expansion coefficients of the cement-based matrix and the aggregate inclusions, resulting in what we term microscopic self-equilibrated stresses, even if there are no macroscopic thermal constraints. The table on the right side of this figure shows thermal expansion coefficients for different materials. The largest one is for quartzite, silica, shale, and chert. The left figure shows the thermal expansion coefficient for the cement paste as a function of the relative humidity. Largest values are about for 63% humidity. And you can see if you compare the curve with the dashed line standing for the largest value of alpha aggregate, that the thermal expansion coefficient for the cement paste is significantly larger than the one for the aggregates. Concrete is a matrix inclusion composite consisting of cement-based aggregate inclusions. Temperature changes result in eigenstrains, easy to compute. Multiply them by the elastic stiffness tensors, you get the stresses, eigenstresses. The transition to the macroscopic scale of concrete is then performed by means of Levin's theory, and the formula for the macroscopic stress tensor contains the homogenized stiffness tensor C con, which in turn contains the volume fractions for the cement paste and for the aggregates, and the strain concentration tensors, which are estimated by means of the Mori-Tanaka method. The formula for the macroscopic stress tensor also contains the macroscopic strain tensor, of course, and the macroscopic eigenstrain and eigenstress tensor. The formula for the latter is given on the top of this slide here. And determination of the thermal expansion coefficient of concrete, which is the actual goal of this part of our research, is based on the assumption that concrete can deform freely. That means it's based on the assumption of the vanishing of the macroscopic stress tensor. After some relatively simple mathematical manipulations, we obtain the expression for the thermal expansion coefficient for concrete, which is given in the yellow box. The homogenized properties of concrete serve as input for macroscopic thermal stress analysis. Conversely, ladies and gentlemen, top-down stress concentration provides access to microscopic thermal stresses in the cement paste and the aggregates as functions of the macroscopic stresses and of the mismatch of the microscopic thermal expansion coefficient. This was tested by a very simple example, namely by multiscale thermomechanical analysis of a simply supported concrete beam with a rectangular cross-section subjected to sudden cooling. The initial condition was a uniform temperature field, T reference. Then sudden cooling was applied at the top surface, cooling down to 0 degrees centigrade, while the temperature at the bottom surface remained at T reference. Thermal insulation of the lateral surfaces was assumed, and this resulted in a very simple one-dimensional heat conduction along the head of the beam, that is along the C direction, providing the temperature load for the analysis. The formula, which can be taken from any textbook, contains A, the thermal diffusivity of concrete. We performed macroscopic, so to say, bottom-up, and microscopic, so to say, top-down stress analysis of a 3D finite element model of a simply supported beam. Please take a look at the left figure. It shows the macroscopic normal stress sigma xx for dimensionless time instance at over h squared. And you see that for the smallest value, 10 to the minus 2, take a look, please, at the blue dashed-dotted curve. There are significant tensile stresses at the upper surface. They're becoming smaller, of course, as the time increases. And when h, t over h squared is 1 with stationary conditions, there are, of course, no stresses because there was no external loading applied. Now, please take a look at the right figure. It shows the microscopic stresses in the cement paste and the aggregates computed at a t over h squared 10 minus 1 with the multiscale model. The tensile stresses you see in the cement are larger than the ones in the aggregate, significantly larger, and this results in an increase of the risk of microcracking. Let me come to the third topic. More deviation is determination of the bearing capacity of concrete hinges at segment-to-segment interfaces. The tunnel consists of several segments, I've said that before. And if you take a look at the upper left figure, you see circumferential joints and longitudinal joints. The figures below refer to these joints. If you take a look at the lowermost figure in the left part of the slide, you will see so-called concrete hinges. And they are the actual topic of our interest. The stress situation here is one that comes from eccentric normal forces. The lining is subjected to external loads, and they come from the soil pressure and from the tunnel boring machine. The concrete hinges must transmit normal forces and bending moments. What is of prime interest is the relative rotation angle. You see it in one of the figures here in the middle of the slide. The present guidelines are limited to serviceability states. Take a look at the right figure. It shows the dimensionless bending moments as a function of the dimensionless rotation at the intersections. The models that are used in engineering practice are quite old, by Leonhard and Janssen, 1965, 1986, and by Gladwell, 1980. The nonlinear part of the curves here is not at all considered. A few words about materials and test specimens. We have tested three nominally identical concrete hinges subjected to eccentric compression line loads. The geometric shape complied with the design guidelines of Leonhard and Reimann. Cross section of the neck was 7.5 by 30 square meters. Take a look at the front view, it's 7.5 centimeters, and at the side view, it's 30 centimeters. Steel plates of 2 centimeters were applied at the top and also a concentrated external eccentric line load. The eccentricity was chosen as 1/3 of the width of the neck, following the design guidelines by Leonhard and Reimann. The maximum value of E was A over 3, and this is a situation where tensile cracking will extend across half of the neck. The figure shows a comparison of measurements from eccentric compression tests with a numerical result from a three-dimensional finite element simulation and with relationships by Gladwell, Leonhard, and Reimann. You see these relationships result in the lines here, and they are actually meaningless. This figure gives you a good impression of our results, but nota bene, the numerical results weren't that good from the very beginning. They were preceded by finite element simulations, 2D finite simulations, first to quantify the triaxiality of the stress state, and second, by three-dimensional finite element simulations with default input values, and thirdly, by micromechanics-assisted updating of input parameters. I'll briefly report on these three items. 2D finite element simulations for the purpose of quantification of the stress triaxiality. We carried out geometrically linear plane strain finite element solutions, failure surfaces by Menetrier-Willem plus Rankine for tension. The figures here on the right-hand side, on the right side of the slide, show the normal stresses along the neck width. for the loading direction at the top, the sickness direction in the middle, and the lateral direction at the lower end. And if the stress level is 1 in the loading direction, compression of course, it is 0.45 in the lateral direction, and it is in the sickness direction and 0.30 in the lateral direction. So it's a printable compressive stress state in 3 directions. That's of course needed for concrete hinges. So the confinement results in strengthening of concrete relative to the uniaxial strength. Now a few words about 3-dimensional FE simulations that were preceding the finite analysis with default input values. Again, geometrically linear 3-dimensional finite element solutions. Again, the same type of failure surfaces. The default values were related to the measured stiffness and strength of concrete. And the results were, of course, disappointing. If you look at the figure on the right-hand side, you can see that the initial stiffness was overestimated by 40% and the bearing capacity was overestimated by 80%. The conclusion was that concrete was damaged already before structural testing. And the reason for this damage is shrinkage. And Professor Pichler will report in his lecture on work in this direction, which is underway. So concrete was damaged already before structural testing. The consequence of this was that we had to perform micromechanics-assisted updating of the input parameters for the 3-dimensional finite element simulations. You see here 3 quantities, the tensile strength, the modulus of elasticity, and the energy release. And you see that they contain a couple of numbers. These are numbers that were obtained from multi-scale analysis. What was the benefit of this? When we reduced the number of fitting parameters from 3 to 1, there's still one fitting parameter in there, which is the quantity omega, the crack density, an optimal value was obtained here for 6.5%. And also it resulted in the desired reduction of 3-axial compressive strength. This, ladies and gentlemen, brings me to the last part of my presentation. It's application of multiscale analysis to real-life structure. In mechanized tunneling, the lining performance depends on the behavior of segment-to-segment joints. The challenge here is that the joints exhibit discontinuities of displacements and rotation. The aim of our research was hybrid analysis with prescribed loading and measured discontinuities as input. Again, a few other words about the motivation. What we wanted to do is reanalysis of a real scale test of a segmented tunnel ring that was carried out at Tongji University in Shanghai. Please take a look at the figure here. It shows the cross-section with 6 segments, diameter of 6.1 meters. The ring was subjected to anisotropic loading imposed by 24 hydraulic jacks up to the ultimate load state. What was measured were the horizontal and the vertical convergences, and the displacement rotation discontinuities at the interfaces of the segments. The homogenized quantities for the modulus of elasticity, Poisson's ratio, and the tensile strength are given at the lower end of the transparency. Hybrid structural analysis of a segmented tunnel ring was based on transfer relations. You see here in this equation the vector of the state variables at an arbitrary cross-section with the angular coordinate phi. It is obtained as the product of a transfer matrix and the vector of state variables at the initial cross-section phi I is 0. So U is the radial displacement, V is the tangential displacement, theta is the cross-sectional rotation, M is the bending moment, N the axial force, and V the shear force. The seventh column in this matrix contains sums, and these sums represent actually sums of load integrals. Starting with UL phi, I'll explain this, then comes VL phi, and so on, and until uppercase VL phi, that refers to the shear forces. As an example, I've written here the load integral of the radial displacement due to a radial load point P at phi P. The respective formula contains the jack force, P, the circumferential position, phi P, and the Heaviside function. I've also listed here a load integral of the radial displacement due to the interfacial discontinuities at phi J. The formula contains delta UJ, delta VJ, and delta theta J interfacial discontinuities. In order to determine the state variables at the initial cross-section, the transfer relations must be specified for phis 2 pi. And this provides a relation between the vectors of the state variables at the initial, subscript I, and the final cross-section, subscript F. So UF is UI, VF is VI, and theta F is theta I. And this provides you with compatibility equations for the moments, the normal forces, and the shear forces. The kinematic state variables at the initial cross-sections, UI, VI, theta I, refer to rigid body motions. They may be set equal to zero. For the purpose of model validation, we reanalyzed the structural test that was performed at Tongji University. The transfer matrix contained 42 load integrals, 24 associated with the prescribed hydraulic jack forces, and 18 with the measured interfacial discontinuities. Cracking of concrete was predicted at load step 4, as was observed experimentally. Take a look at the right figure here. It shows a comparison of the model predicted convergences with the measured convergences, and the degree of agreement is quite reasonable. By the way, this is a non-trivial assessment of the predicted capabilities of the model because the measured convergences are independent of the analysis input, and there are no fitted parameters. This slide here shows results for the deformations for the first four load steps. The magnification factor of the displacement is 50. We have symmetrical loading, and we have an unsymmetrical structural response resulting from small initial geometrical imperfections. This brings me to the conclusions. I hope I didn't overexceed available time. First topic, microstructural analysis of impact and blast loading of tunnel linings. I repeat what I've said before, no matter how short a stress pulse exceeding the quasi-static static strength may be, damage of tunnel linings will occur. Second topic, since the thermal expansion coefficient of the cement paste is typically much larger than the one of the aggregates, the tensile stresses in the cement paste are larger than the ones in the aggregates and in the matrix inclusion composite concrete in case of sudden cooling. And this will result in an increase of the risk of cracking. Thirdly, the finite element simulations of the concrete hinges at the interfaces of neighboring segments of the tunnel lining allowed for quantifying the triaxial compressive stress state prevailing in the neck region of the hinges and for reproducing their nonlinear structural behavior right up to the bearing capacity. And last but not least, a real scale test of a segmented tunnel ring carried out at Tongji University was reproduced numerically by means of multi-scale structural analysis based on a combination of a multi-scale micromechanics model for concrete and transfer relations for structural analysis of tunnel rings. This brings me to the conclusion, from the conclusions, bridging the gap in the form of several orders of magnitude in material mechanics of concrete by means of multi-scale analysis has opened new perspective of structural analysis of tunnel linings. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your attention.